appreciate all of you coming. And that's our daughter, Jennifer, and the boys and girls in the band. Sometimes they have almost an all-girl band. You did good, son. Keep practicing. There are some seats up front here, guys. I mean, I promise you, you won't get wet. Maybe. Plenty of seats. A couple announcements. If you're a junior high or middle school or high school, right through that door into the metal building, there are youth going on, dynamic youth. And if you'd like to go there, feel free. For those who claim Grace Life as your church, this is Halloween tomorrow night. And pick up some of these cards. It's advertising for Grace Life. Now, be sure you put candy in there, too. You know, if you put that in there, you don't put any candy, then Jamie's going to get calls. So, but it's a good advertise, a good way, and you never know who's looking for a church sometimes. So do that. Lori, please stand. Pray for Lori. Her mother fell this week and 3 days later passed away. And the funeral's tomorrow, Tuesday, 2 o'clock, Maranatha Fellowship, and visitations at 1. And we sure love Lori. Throw some love toward her, would you? Bless her, Jesus. Wow, what an honor, what a joy to preach. Let's stand up, and I'm going to read from 2 Kings, the 4th chapter, verse 1 through 7. 2 Kings, 4th chapter, 1 through 7. I'm preaching on the power of the anointing. A certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets. They had a Bible school in those days. And Elisha was in charge of the Bible school. He was mentoring these young preachers. And this woman, she's crying out, verse 1. Certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophet cried out. That means to weep uncontrollably. The sound of a broken heart. She said to Elisha, "Your servant, my husband, is dead." One of the preachers. "And you know that your servant feared the Lord, and the creditor is coming to take my two sons to be slaves." In those days, if you had debts you couldn't pay, you couldn't file bankruptcy. You had to take care of that debt, and most of the time the creditor would come and make you their slave until it was paid for. In the Old Testament, the seventh year was a year of Jubilee. And that means all debts were set free, and we are living right now in the year of Jubilee because of the Lord. You can say amen. Some of you, God have mercy. So Elijah said to her, "What shall I do for you? What do you want me to do? Tell me, what is in your house? What do you have in your house?" And she said, "Your maidservant has nothing. Nothing in the house, oh, but a little jar of oil." Then he said, "Go and borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors." Look at that. Go everywhere, borrow them from all of your neighbors, empty vessels. Do not gather just a few. That's a key. "And when you have come in, you shall shut the door behind you, and your sons then pour it, the little jar of oil, into all those vessels." Sounds crazy. "Set aside the full ones." So she went from him and shut the door behind her and her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured it out. Now it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said to her son, "Bring me another vessel." And he said to her, "Mama, there ain't no more vessels." So the oil ceased. And she came and told the man of God, and he said, "Go, sell the oil and pay your debt, and you and your sons shall live on the rest." Father, anoint your messenger and anoint the message and give people hearing ears in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Praise God. God is good, isn't he? Yes. Now, here's a widow of a preacher. And this widow is crying out in despair. Her heart is broken. Don't know what killed him. Don't know why he died. But he was in Bible college. He was being mentored by Elisha. And all of a sudden he dies. And she's in total despair. Now, verse 1 says that her dead husband has left her in deep debt. Don't know if you know it or not, but churches are notorious at making sure that the pastor lives under what they live under. I can't get no help over here. Come over here. There's a bunch of rich people over here, I can tell, looking at you. What do you mean? Well, I'll give you for instance. I know one man who, in a waiting upon God, testified that he was a deacon in a church. And he said he felt like that his job was to make sure that the preacher didn't make too much money. I remember when I was pastoring Maranatha Fellowship, and they bought the only parsonage. It was in Nitra up on a hill on 15th Street. I remember one of the members came and was working on it. And when he looked at the house, it was a beautiful home up on the hill. It had 7 acres. And he said these words to me. He said, "I get a burden about this house." Well, I knew what he meant. It was bigger than the one he had. You and I told him. I said, "It doesn't burden me." But it's amazing how many people, even in this room, have the idea, because you hear about a preacher's. I preached recently on our Bible college here, and I taught about the richest preachers in America, and it's amazing. One evangelist in America on TV, he is worth $750 million. I'm an evangelist. I'm not worth $750 million yet. But if you want to give to us, there's a little box back there that says Right Way Ministry. That's called a commercial. Deep in debt. Didn't make plans. There were no credit cards. He's not in debt because of credit cards. He has bought more things than he can afford. He has been obligated now to someone who's going to come and collect the debt. In my estimation, the debtor, the credit guy that's coming, the creditor that's coming, I kind of put him in the classification of the devil. He's coming to steal, kill, and rob. He is going to rob this widow of her future. Because her dead husband provided for the family. He's gone, and now these two boys are obligated to take care of her mommy, and they're going to be stolen away by the creditor. She's deep in debt. As I look out over this crowd, I can tell maybe some of you are deep in debt. But you ought to thank God you're under the new covenant. Anybody in the house? Yeah. You better thank God that you're not having a creditor come and make you a slave. Amen. Brother, would you please don't take any more pictures? Thank you. You're so sweet. Put that on Time Magazine if you would. I say that because when I'm preaching, I want everybody's focus. And I found out in church, men who could watch a ball game burn their house down, they don't lose their focus. But in church, anything happens, they lose their focus. So stay with me, because the message is crucial. She's in desperate need of a miracle. Somewhere between your birth and your death, you're going to need a miracle. I wouldn't go to a church that didn't believe in miracles. I wouldn't give a preacher or a congregation a dime that they didn't believe in miracles. I had many people come to the Maryland Fellowship when I was pastor there. They would come on a Sunday night, and they'd come forward, and they'd ask for healing. And so I said, "Well, where do you go to church?" And they'd name their church. I said, "Why don't you go down there and have them pray for you?" And this was what they say: they don't believe in miracles. I said, "Why in the world would you go to a church that doesn't believe in miracles? Because I'm looking at you, and young ones, you better hear me too. Somewhere between your birth and your death, you're going to need a miracle. And there's only one miracle worker. His name's not Buddha." I'd love to get on Buddha. His name is Jesus. And this woman is desperately in need of a miracle, because the creditor's coming. Now, verse 1 tells us her only hope is to seek direction from the man of God. Now, I believe that you can get in this book and you can read the word and you can pray and the Holy Ghost can tell you what you need to do. But I also know that there are times in my life, my wife's life, in our ministry, in our family, that we needed direction, that we did not know where to go, and we went to a man of God. I believe that there are still prophets on the planet. Say amen. Amen. I believe there are still apostles on the planet. Apostles are not someone with a halo around their head. The word apostle means sent one. There are men and women of God that God sends for specific assignments on this planet. I tell you what, I believe that 2 Chronicles 20:20 says, if you believe God, you shall be established, settled, locked in. And if you believe, this is Chronicles, 2 Chronicles 20:20, if you believe his prophets, you shall prosper. Does anyone want to prosper here? Four of us, five of us, rest of you are humble. Just give your blessing to me. Prosper. What do you mean? Succeed. I believe that God still has men and women of God that can get guidance from God to help us along this journey. Say amen. Amen. Verse 2, Elijah asks her two questions. Two questions. Now, when I'm counseling people, my mentor, Reverend Lorne Helm, told me years ago, he said, son, it's better for people not to know God's will than to know God's will and not do it. I have counseled more people in 45 years of pastoring that didn't hear what I said. A young man came to me one time and he wanted to buy a new house and he wanted no direction. And I began to ask him questions. And I said, well, the house you live in now, can you afford it? He said, no. I said, so you can't make the payments in the house? No, I can't make them. And now, how big is this one you're getting ready to buy? Oh, it's bigger than the one I'm living in. I said, son, if you can't afford the house you're living in, you surely cannot afford a bigger house. And I said, don't buy it. And of course, you know what he did. He did exactly what I told him not to do. He bought it. Few weeks, few months later, he has to sell it. He's bankrupt. I'm telling you, if you're asking a man of God for direction, then do what they tell you to do. Don't let them manipulate you. I'm not in the manipulation. I'm not in this stuff, thus saith Daddy said for me to tell you, and all it is me manipulating you. Those are con men. But the true men of God can give you a word from God in a specific situation and help you out. First question. Listen to what he says. What do you want me to do for you? Now, he just heard her say that her husband had died. He feared the Lord. He was in your Bible college. But yet he asked the question, what do you want me to do for you? In Mark 10:51, Jesus asked the blind man. Now, he knew the man was blind. But he asked the blind man, what do you want me to do for you? That is a blank check. Some of you don't have what you need because you're scared to death to ask God for it. You're like someone shopping. You know, I'm just looking. I'm not looking. When I go shopping, I could park in the 20-minute zone because I know what I'm going in there for. And when I get in there, I kill it. I drag it to the cash register. I buy that sucker, and I'm back at my car in 12 minutes and 32 seconds. Anybody in the house? But my wife is just shopping. Finds a dress. I say, sweetheart, this is it. I mean, shoo. Lord have mercy. You look gorgeous in that dress. She says, well, I don't think. We look around 20 stores, come back to the very first store 3 hours later, and she says, I think I'll buy this one. 3 hours. Any men in the house? I said, thank God. Thank God she found that dress. And I said, let's get out of here. And she said, oh, honey, I don't have the shoes to match the dress. I don't buy new shoes every time I buy a pair of pants. We look, there are more shoe stores in there. Have you ever noticed where the men's section is? You have to get a map and a GPS to find the men's section. But when you walk in the store, the women's section's everywhere. We get the shoes, we have the dress, we're ready to roll. She says, sweetheart. I said, what is it? She says, I don't have a purse to match the shoes to match the dress. How many of you men buy a new wallet every time you buy a pair? You need to be definite in your requests when you go to God. You need to pinpoint your prayers. Don't just come up here and say, Lord, what? I've heard people say, Lord, whatever you want to give me. Excuse me? Pinpoint your prayer. Be specific when you ask God for something. Well, here comes. But what if he doesn't do it? We'll slap you upside the head. In love. But get on the other side of the fence. What if he does do it? My Lord, you're going to prayer and you're already decided that he's not going to do it. So thus you're afraid to. Man, I'm a big asker. I ask for big things. I ask God. I don't know about you, but I believe my God can do anything. And I believe that he wants to do things for us. I really do. First question, what do you want me to do for you? He doesn't even give, if you look at verse 2, he doesn't give her a chance to even answer it. Instantly, after he asks the first question, he asks the second question. The second question is, what do you have in your house? I don't know if you know it or not, but she has nothing in her house. She says nothing. You know why nothing? Because she sold everything in her house of value to pay that creditor. Is there anybody here that would get rid of your big TV if it meant saving your child's life? Give me a hand here, would you? How many of you would save your daughter if it meant all your furniture would be sold? You'd get rid of all that stuff, wouldn't you? The creditors come to steal her sons, and she's gotten rid of everything. She said, I have nothing in my house. That's what she said, nothing. Everything of any value has been sold to help pay that creditor, and she still doesn't have enough. She doesn't have a couch, and she doesn't have a TV. How can you live without a TV? My Lord, she doesn't even have cable. I don't know how to God she could get through life without cable. She doesn't even have a cell phone now. She had to give her cell phone up. Pastor Jamie constantly tells people, turn to your Bible. If you don't have your Bible, you have your iPad or your iPhone. Turn to your... I'm leery. I don't trust some of you. Yeah, you got your iPhone out acting like you're looking at 2 Kings, 4th chapter. And you're playing some game on there. I know what you're doing. Okay, for someone beside you that's looking at an iPhone, make sure they're looking at the Bible. If they're not the Bible, just holler at me and I'll come back and chastise them. In love. Can I get a witness? So she says nothing. Quick response. I don't have anything. And all of a sudden, she said, well, I believe there's a little jar of oil left in the house. Now, here's a woman that has nothing of value in her house. The only thing she's got left is a little jar of oil. And this little jar of oil had almost been forgotten. Oil is used throughout the Old and New Covenant to represent the anointing of the Holy Spirit. They anointed kings and prophets and priests. Revelation says that if you're saved, 2nd chapter, he's made you a priest and a king. That means that you are in line for the anointing. Amen. King David, little David, when Samuel came to Jesse's house because the Holy Ghost had led, Saul was getting rejected because of what he was doing. And Samuel came and said, Jesse, how many boys you got? And he said, well, here's the oldest. When he came forward, and Samuel thought, well, he's so good looking. He's built like a man. I'm going to anoint him. God says, no, he's not the one. He goes through 6 of them. He said, man, none of them are the right one, because God looks at the heart. And he said, do you have any more kids? And he says, well, I got a little kid out there. He's herding the sheep. He looks like Howdy Doody. How many of you know who Howdy Doody is? I said that in the first service, and they go, who's Howdy Doody? Help some people in the world, would you? Claire Bell? Buffalo Bob? You people are old. The Bible says that he was redheaded, freckled face, and Samuel says, I'm not going to move until he comes. When he comes into the door, I mean, if you look to the outside, you'd go, oh my. He took the horn of oil and poured it and anointed David to be the king as a teenager. Listen to me. The next chapter, he kills a giant because he had a warrior's anointing on him. Listen to me, church. The oil that she had almost forgotten, if you look around, Sometimes we begin to doubt whether or not the oil has enough value in it to meet my need. The oil had become seemingly useless and insignificant. The oil, the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Today in the modern church, we're calling the oil non-essential. I know churches that their criteria for getting a pastor to lead the flock and feed souls is how many degrees they've got. I'm not concerned. I have a doctorate degree, but I'm not concerned about how many degrees the preacher has. I want to know how much fire the preacher has. I know a church that turned a man of God down because his wife couldn't play the piano. They were wanting two for the price of one. Anybody still in the house? See, the modern church thinks that the anointing oil is nonsense. Why? Because we have programs. All kinds of programs. But we don't have any power. Form. Oh, my Lord and my God. So form. It's amazing. We look sharp. We come in. We have all kind of forms, all kind of rituals. Listen to me. We have form, but no fire. Now, I'm not talking about people going crazy, but I tell you what, there ought to be some passion. You come to church, you sit on not on a log. You sit there. It's amazing. You go everywhere else, and you're passionate about this, you're passionate about that. You come to church, my Lord and my God, you just sit there, and you don't do nothing. Brother, you got to get passionate about Jesus. If I could check you out and talk to you a little while, I could take your temperature, and I could find out what you're passionate about. Because, Brother Wright, I'm not like that. I'm an introvert. You're a lying dog. You're passionate about something. I like to watch the velocity where they have these cars and these old cars and they auction these cars off. And I had, when I was in college with my precious bride, I had a 67 GTO. And the people, when we took our first church, they didn't feel like it was kind of like a ministry car. It had a 4-speed hearse on the floor. It had a chrome engine. Had 400 cubic inches, 335 horsepower. But it wasn't a preacher's car. And I'm watching Velocity, and they're selling cars. They're auction cars off. And I see a 67 GTO come across the auction block. $85,000. Boy, I'd like to find those deacons in that church. In love. Pray for me. Would you pray for me? See, we have all kinds of sermons with nobody getting saved. You preach 52 weeks out of a year, not one soul saved. God have mercy, you need a prayer meeting. Listen to me. We have all kinds of messages with no miracles. Rituals coming out of our ears, but no revival. Brother, there's value in the anointing oil of the Holy Ghost. Say amen. Amen. The anointing of the Holy Spirit is God's way of equipping us to do that which we cannot do on our own. You have an assignment. Everyone has an assignment. God has a purpose for every human being on the planet. And listen to me. You can't accomplish what God wants you to accomplish on your own power and strength. It's not by power nor by might, but it's by His Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. You need the anointing to flow. Listen to me. To flow on you, in you, and through you. You never know instantly when you need an anointing. Everywhere you go, you should be anointed. Everywhere you go, you never know when someone's going to need you, and this anointing will help you. I'm home on a Sunday afternoon. The phone rings, and I say, Pastor Wright. And the lady says, who? And I said, Pastor Wright. I said, who are you looking for? She said, I must have the wrong number, but I need a preacher. And without me asking, she starts telling me all of her problems. I'm a stranger to her. But she knows I'm a preacher. And she starts telling me about this one's died and that one's near death and I don't know what I'm going to do. She starts crying on the phone. I need an anointing right now. I need an anointing for the right word at the right time. So I say, can I pray for you? She said, yes. She's a total stranger. I don't even know her name. And yet a phone call comes and I'm beginning to minister to a lady that I don't even know who she is. And I'm praying. And God pinpoints to prayer exactly what she needs because there's an anointing flowing in me and through me. Say, well, Brother Wright, I'm not a preacher. Everyone has an opportunity to have the anointing flow through them to help somebody. If you do it on your own, it's called flesh. We could pal all your flesh up here and it still profits what? Zip. Zero. But the Spirit, when the Spirit anoints you, oh, Brother Wright, I'm not worthy. Oh, God. I got a headache here. What do you mean you're not worthy? God loves you. He loves you so much He sent Jesus to save you. He makes you worthy. And He wants to use you. In peculiar ways, He wants to use you. Luke 4th chapter, verse 18 through 20, Jesus preaches His first sermon. Now I'm interested. The Son of the Living God is preaching His very first sermon in His hometown church. Now let's just suppose, what do you think that the King of all kings is going to preach on for His first sermon? The cross? No. No. His blood? No. His resurrection? No. Luke, the 4th chapter, verse 18, Jesus gets up in His hometown church and He opens the scroll to Isaiah 61. He begins to say these words, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me and He has anointed me." Wait a minute. A.W. Tozer said these words. Listen to him. A.W. Tozer said that Jesus Christ did not do miracles on this planet in His divinity. I believe that Jesus was God and man. But A.W. Tozer said Jesus did all miracles and everything He did by the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Because He tells us that we're going to do greater works than He did, and we are not divine, and we are not God, and how in the world we're going to do anything without the anointing. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and He has anointed me," and then He gives everything that the anointing accomplishes. Read it. It's awesome. If you read Luke, the 4th chapter, verse 18 through 20, tells you all the things the anointing will do. And then He closes up the book, puts it down, and goes over and sits down. And when He sits down, every eye is upon Him. Well, why? Well, let me tell you why. Because in every synagogue, there was a seat for Elijah and there was a seat for the Messiah. And no one ever sat in those seats. They were expecting Elijah to come back, who was raptured away. They're expecting the Messiah to show up. When Jesus read those words, He sat down in the seat where the Messiah sat. Well, how do you know that? Because it wasn't unusual to read Scripture in the synagogue. And every eye was upon Him. It says, after He sat down, every eye was upon Him. And just a few moments later, they got so mad that they took Him, thrust Him out of the synagogue, thrust Him all the way through Nazareth to the crown of the... Nazareth's way up on a hill, and there's a cliff there. They were going to push Him over the... They were going to kill Him because He sat down in the Messiah's seat. As they're getting ready to kill Him, the Bible says, and He walked through their midst. Well, how did He do that? He became invisible. You will find out reading the gospel that there's more than one time that they're out to kill Him, and as Chris says, and He walks through their midst. It doesn't mean they were frozen or they were blind. It means that He became invisible. You say, well, He couldn't do that. He's greater than Superman. He's greater than Batman. Now they got a Superwoman. They got a Superwoman out there now. She has an outfit and she got an S on it. It says Superwoman. What is the world coming to? I got the crowd turning on me, Lord. I need Your help quickly. Verse 3, the Lord gives her divine instructions. Go borrow empty vessels. Go everywhere and borrow empty vessels. Borrow all the vessels you can. That's what He says. And then as a side note, He says, don't borrow just a few. The prophet believed that the oil was more than enough to meet the need. Notice Elijah puts no limit on the size of the miracle. The only limit to the size of the miracle this widow and her two boys are going to have is the size of her preparation. Brother Gary, would you help me quickly? So they're going everywhere, knocking on doors. Now everybody in town, all of y'all are going to watch him. He's just putting out some vessels. What's he doing, Mama? I don't know, but he's putting out something. He's putting out vessels. Listen to me. Everyone in that town knew that she didn't have anything left. I mean, excuse me? It's a little community. They all knew her. She didn't have nothing left. She'd sold everything. Matter of fact, some of them had bought her couch. They knew. And she's knocking on doors. She comes to the first door. The neighbor opens the door. And, how you doing? Good to see you. Oh, I'm so sorry about your husband. Thank you. Do you have any empty vessels? Now, men, you know as well as I do that that woman that she just asked if she had any empty vessels, you know that that woman is going to ask, what do you need them for? Hello? I mean, she's going to ask, what do you need it for? And she's going to have to tell her, well, the man of God has told me to go borrow empty vessels. And when I borrow them, I'm going to take this little jar of oil. I'm going to fill them all up. And the neighbor's going to say, I told you. You shouldn't go down to that Grace Life Church. I told you they're crazy down there. I don't know if you know it or not. But the father of the pastor, he started that crazy church up in St. Albans. And they handle snakes and all kind of stuff. Oh, I had more stuff told about me and Carter got peanuts. She has to go to every neighbor everywhere. That means she has to go to some neighbors that she doesn't even like. She has to knock on doors of people she doesn't like and ask them for empty vessels. I guarantee you when she leaves, that neighbor's gathered outside. He said, did you know what Judy did? What she did? She came to my house. She came to yours too? She's crazy. I told her if she went to church over 3 times a week, she's going to lose her mind. I had an uncle, went to church all the time, flipped out, crazy as a lunatic. And she's hanging around that Elisha. Oh, I'm telling you, weirdos everywhere, and she's going around door to door asking for empty vessels. She told me she's got a little valve oil, it ain't big as nothing, and I gave her a jar that big. Do you know it says here that she's to shut the door? You know why? You better shut all those skeptics. You better shut out all the people trying to talk you out of your miracle. There are certain people you cannot allow into your life because they will talk you out of God's miracle. I love people. I like to be around people. But I'm here to tell you, if you're not careful, you will associate with the wrong people. And anytime God tells you to do something, they're going to try to talk you out of it. You hear me? And if you hesitate long enough, you're going to lose your opportunity for your miracle. Because everything has a season. Everything has a season. It has a beginning. It has an end. To all things, there is a season. Listen to me. And if you're not careful, you'll hesitate. And you'll wait and wait and wait. And someone will keep talking to you negatively. And your season will pass. I know whereof I speak. There's certain people you got to shut out. You said, Brother Wright, that doesn't sound like love. I'm telling you, there are certain people. I very seldom ever use the words the Lord told me. Some of these guys have visions every second and dreams every night. Very few times in my ministry did I say the Lord told me. But when the Lord told me, I could tell you, you can take it to the bank. And without fail, that was the very time when the Lord told me something that people would rise up and say, well, I don't see that. I felt like saying, there's no wonder. A question. We're going to take a vote. All the way in the back. Everybody get ready. We're going to take a vote. Now, I want everyone to vote. How many of you already voted in the election? How many of you already voted? A few of you. How many of you plan on voting? Better vote. People ask me all the time, who should you vote for? I'm voting for people that are against abortion. Let me tell you, they could be ugly and have weird-looking hairdos. But I'm not voting for a liberal. I'm not voting for a liberal. I'm not voting for a liberal. I didn't vote for a liberal. Now, they got vessels of different sizes. People just gave it. Lord have mercy. God, you need a crane to move that sucker. So we go all the way down. Some of you back can't see. We're all the way down. We're all the way down. So someone gave her a little cup. So here we are, gigantic, down to a little cup. This. Can you see it in the back? Kathy Armstead brought this one in. Does anybody know what this is? How many in the house, here comes our vote, how many in the house believe that the very first vessel that she filled up was this one? How many believe that? She believes it. I've got some swamp land I want to sell you. How many of you believe she started with this little cup? You know she did. You know she started with the smallest one. She started, listen to me, the little vial of oil was so small. Here you got a little vial of oil, and the first, and reluctantly she releases her faith. Because the only thing she had was a little bottle of oil. She releases her faith, and she begins to pour. It says, shut the door, begin to pour. So she takes the little vial of oil, and she begins to pour. And it fills to the brim. And she looks, and the vial of oil is smaller than the cup, but yet the cup's full. She gets excited. Would you get excited? Would some of you Presbyterians get excited? Sometimes I preach and I want to go back and take people's pulse. I think they've died. One lady told me one time, says, you're too fanny. You're too fanny. You're too fanny. You ought not be that fanny. I said, you're too boring. Don't have enough burdens in life. I know people that don't think you should laugh in church. You should not laugh in church. I'd laugh. Some of these preachers get up there and they got a robe, you know, and they stand there and they talk like I've never heard people talk like, we're so glad you're here today. Do you talk like that out there? It's called preacher talk. We're so glad God is in the house. You ever go to church and they've got just an organ and a piano? And you come in and the organ's playing. You walk in, everybody's real quiet. And you hear the organ. I'm thinking I'm in a haunted house. She fills up the next one. She fills up the next one. I believe. Y'all love me. I believe she got excited when she got about the third vessel filled up. I believe she got so excited she put oil all over the place. I believe there was oil everywhere. I believe they were slipping. I believe they were getting slain in their spirit. I believe, man, the house was full of oil, the smell of fragrant oil. I mean, they were shouting. The two boys were just lapping around, hooping and hollering. You cannot tell me she wasn't excited. Missy, I'll tell you what I did. I threw water all over the place. Missy can't see, but she can see more than some of you.
I tell you, you can't tell me that when she got to the last one, this huge one, and she's pouring oil. I'm telling you what, she's a hooping and a hollering. She's throwing oil in there, and when it gets to the brim, filled up, she's so excited. If you read your scripture, she says, "Boys, bring me another vessel." And they say these words, "Mama, we don't have no more." Do you think she was disappointed? The anointing has eyes. Because it says in the scripture, when that last vessel was filled up, the anointing ceased. It had eyes. God loves emptiness. Have you ever heard anybody say, "Sam, they're just full of themselves"? God doesn't anoint people that are full of themselves. He doesn't anoint people that are full of pride, ego. People say, you're awful cocky. I'm not cocky. I'm Savior confidence. Amen. The oil ceased when it could not find anything else that was empty. Go and sell. I don't believe in merchandising the anointing. I don't believe in these preachers that get up there and they say, "You can buy a miracle today if you'll send in $89.95. And con men. I don't send them a dime. The anointing has so much value. In Isaiah 10, verse 27, it says, "The anointing will lift the burden and destroy the yoke that binds you, that limits you." Listen to me. The anointing took care of her debt. The anointing removed the debt. It not only removed the debt, it gave her and her two boys enough to live on the rest of their life. That's what it says. I believe that we in the church need to get hold of the fact that the anointing is valuable. The Spirit gives life. But the letter, the religious rules, gives death. I preach everywhere. I preach in all kinds of churches. I preach in your church, if someone burps, they think the Holy Ghost is moving. I mean, quiet. But every church, every group I go, they all have their own rules. There are certain places, if you go, you can't wear a watch. Because they believe, "Are you okay, Em?" "Okay, you start having pains, you let me know." Got a baby over there coming. You can't wear a watch. Some places you can't wear a wedding ring. Cecil, did you ever grow up in a church that preached against wedding rings? I grew up in a church that preached against neckties. I'm thinking about starting another church. But these are all man-made rules. And they bring death. There are certain places that the women are judged by the length of their hair. And if you got short hair, you're not holy. And some of them got beehives so big, it's amazing. I wonder, do they ever worship them? Ooh. And they're judging people by the length of their hair. The Spirit gives life. Law gives death. You have needs. And some of them are bigger than you. I believe that the anointing of the Holy Spirit can handle every need. David comes back to God in the 92nd chapter of Psalms. He's already been anointed. Samuel anointed him. But here in 92 Psalms, David says, "I've been anointed with fresh oil." Now to some of you, it may not mean anything. You know, that's your privilege. You can come and let stuff go in one ear and out the other. But there's a few that realize God wants to use me. I'm not saved to sit. I'm saved to serve. Every pastor I talk to, they say, "Preacher, I can't get anybody to be committed to do anything." And we use people that just because they have a pulse and they're breathing. Not anointed, just they have a pulse and they're breathing. We need anointed people. Ushers need to be anointed. Greeters need to be anointed. We need to be anointed when we leave this place. Wherever you work, wherever you shop, when you step into a room, the atmosphere should change. A great man of God said these words, "The anointing has a fragrance." Listen to me. "The anointing has a fragrance that attracts the favor of God." If I began to tell you how blessed I am, some of you have trouble with it. I go to a shop. I go to Greg Chandler's shop to take our little yellow hardtop convertible Mercedes sports car. I'm sitting in the office. A lady walks in. She goes over to the desk. She starts writing a check. I think she's paying the people that at the desk, the office lady. And I'm sitting there. I'm checking all my important messages. "How you doing?" "Good. How you doing?" All of a sudden, the lady turns to me. And she said, "The Lord told me to give you this." I said, "Thank God." I looked down. It started with a 2. And then a 0. And then a 0. And then a 0. $2,000. In a garage. The lady walks in. Sits down and writes me a $2,000 check. Does that burden you? It didn't burden me. You say, "Why are you telling that?" I believe that the anointing has a fragrance to it that attracts the favor of God. People say, "Oh, brother, right? Yeah, nothing good ever happens to me." Well, seek God. Ask the Lord to anoint you, not for things. I didn't ask for that. It just flows out of the anointing. Stand to your feet. I hope I haven't bored you. I know one thing. Some of you need miracles. Some of you, bow your heads for just a moment of prayer. Some of you need a real miracle in your debt. Your debt. You got a huge debt. I challenge you. Come to the altar and tell Jesus exactly what you need. He knows, but tell him. You have not because you ask not. Some of you know that God's called you and you have a purpose in your life. The Lord has saved you. I'm not against you coming and saying, "Lord, I'm empty on my own. I can't do it. But I need the anointing. I need the supernatural unction of God to use me everywhere I go." I challenge you to come to this altar and just say, "Lord, here I am. Anoint me and use me." Your burden today that you're carrying can be lifted by the anointing. That which binds you, which pulls you and ties you down from doing God's will, that can be destroyed today through the anointing. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I tell you, He loves you. He loved you so much, He gave His life for you. 1 John says, if you'll confess your sin, now you don't have to list all of your sins, just admit that you're a sinner and the only Savior is Jesus. Ask Him. He's faithful. He's just to forgive you. There's an anointing in this house. Jennifer, we're just singing in Jesus' name. The altar's open. You come. Whatever your need.
There is a sweet,
sweet
anointing in the sanctuary.
If you know it, sing
there
it.
There is a stillness in the atmosphere.
Anybody else?
He is here.
Do you believe it?
He is here to break the yoke,
break
and lift the heavy burden. He is here. He is here to heal the helpless heart and bless the broken.
Virginia, would you come here and help me just a moment? Would you anoint everyone this altar? Just anoint him in Jesus' name. Just anoint him in Jesus' name. I anoint you in Jesus' name. Name above all names, I anoint you in Jesus' name. He knows the need. He knows what it is. I anoint you in Jesus' name. He's going to use you around. I anoint you in Jesus' name. My brother, I anoint you in Jesus' name. I anoint you in Jesus' name. My brother, I anoint you in Jesus' name. Father, it's not in the oil, it's in you. And Lord, I'm praying for that yoke-destroying, burden-lifting anointing to flow in this house. If you're here and you do not know Christ, if you'll follow me in this prayer, and I want everyone to pray it, say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm a sinner. You are the only Savior. Forgive me of my sins. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I thank you for your death. I thank you for the blood. I thank you for the resurrection. From this day forward, I will follow you by your grace, by your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Sing it one more time. You may be seated. We're getting ready to do something.
There is a sweet anointing in the sanctuary.
Yes.
There is a stillness in the atmosphere. Come and lay down the burdens you have carried in the sanctuary.
God is here.
God is here.
We're going to close this service. We're going to ordain Larry. Pastor Larry Hammett, would you come and your precious wife come here if you would? Pastor Larry and Sarah have served in the work of the kingdom of God for many, many years. Right here if you would, both of you. And God, I don't understand sometimes what churches do. But this man of God, his ordination was taken away, not because of any sin, but because he promoted another church a little bit. I'm amazed what churches do. But Right Way Ministry, which I am the chairman of, we're ordaining you today. I'd like Brother Jerry, Virginia Ruth are on my board. Any ordained ministers in the house, please come forward. We're going to anoint this couple and ordain them today. We're going to take a vote. How many believe this is okay? We don't take the no votes. Would you stretch your hand toward this precious couple? Brother Larry, I anoint you. In the name of Jesus, you're already ordained by Him. He's called you. And He's not done with you. I anoint your handmaiden. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus. For this precious couple that loves you, I lay my hands on them. And I commission them to the new season they're in. Yes. And I thank you, Lord, with this new season, there's a fresh anointing. Yes. And Lord, on this October the 30th, 2016, Right Way Ministry has the honor, the privilege, and the joy of ordaining Pastor Larry Hammett. Thank you. We bless you. We bless them. We thank you for their friends that have come to honor them this day. And Lord, we look to you. For you know that you're not done with this couple. And Lord, you're going to use them. And I bless them today in Jesus' holy name. And everyone said amen.
Amen.
Put your hands together. This is for you. We love you.
Thank you, brother.
Appreciate you. Stand to your feet, congregation. Bless you, Sarah. Sure appreciate you. Thank you all for coming. Did anybody get any help today? Give Him all the glory. Well, one last thing I want to share with you. At 2 o'clock today, I graduated from Nitro High School. And at 2 o'clock today, they're having their very first, they're inducting 5 people into a Hall of Achievement there at the school. The principal of the school called me a few weeks ago, and I've been nominated to be inducted today into the Hall of Achievement. If I have achieved anything, it's because of Jesus and this beautiful blonde in the front row. We love you. Lord, bless these people. We thank you that they came. Father, may the hunger increase. May their thirst increase. For you feel anyone and everyone that's hungry and thirsty. I bless them. I bless their ministry. As they go, Lord, throughout this day, may it be a wonderful day of doing what you've called them to do and using them in the kingdom. Bless Pastor Jamie, Lord, as he begins to preach there in Oulton, Oklahoma, at the Oulton Christ Fellowship. Give him a safe journey home tonight, he and Matthew. And bless, we pray, Lisa and the Grace Life congregation in Jesus' name. Amen. We love you. Lisa, go to the back and shake hands. Virginia, you go back there with her if you would. Larry, if you want any pictures, I'm up. We love you. God bless you.